Hi, everyone. If you come frequently, you might recognize me. My name's Lindsay Goodale. I am an Equine Extension Specialist here at Cornell, and I'm very excited, just quickly before we introduce our speaker, for a couple of people you might recognize. Dr. Kelly Nickelbein is an ophthalmologist who has given a talk on this series before, and she's here. You'll be seeing a lot more of her because she's going to become involved in the seminar series. And Dr. Callum Donnelly, who's a little newer, he's a theriogenologist. He's also becoming more involved. They're both not so secret horse people and are really excited to get involved with this. So you'll see a lot more of them. And they'll be around to kind of help answer questions and moderate for our guest of honor, Dr. Doug Antczak. He tonight is presenting on mules, although it's one of many, many possible areas he could have presented on. He has a lot of areas of expertise, including genetics, which I think is what some of you will recognize him from, because he gave us a genetics talk on for horses a year ago, I guess, and had a lot of polls that time, which were popular, and he has more polls this evening, so that'll be fun. For those of you who don't already know him, Dr. Doug Antczak is here at Cornell at the Baker Institute. He's a veterinarian and has a PhD, and he's studied a lot of things to do with horses, mostly reproduction, immunology, genetics, and has bred many mules and hinnies. And so he has a special insight on that from an academic perspective and a practical perspective. So he's going to be sharing some of the history of the mule and kind of their importance in the world, I think. And we're all very excited. And thank you very much, Dr. Antczak, for joining us.
Thanks, Lindsay. It's great to be back here again. Look forward to the discussion. So should I just go ahead and screen share and start?
Please do, yeah.
All right.
Whenever you're ready. Thank you.
Here we go. All right, I hope people can see this. Topic for this evening is, why is the mule the most important member of the horse family? So tonight we're going to cover a couple of topics in these sections. We'll have an introduction to the family of horse. We'll talk about the enduring utility of the mule, and a scientific session on the contribution of the mule to advances in our understanding of biology. And then we'll have an examination at the end, so please pay attention. I work up here at the Baker Institute for Animal Health, overlooking the Cornell campus. I'm sitting right here in the farmhouse tonight where I have my office. It's a lovely place to be. And I also, over the past 30 years or so, have been responsible for the McConville barn, where we've bred horses and donkeys and mules for a variety of research experiments. And it's a beautiful, beautiful location at Cornell, and hope you'll get a chance to visit if you come to Ithaca. Now, I want to tell you a little bit about my background. As Lindsay said, I've been a mule breeder for over 30 years, but I've been a mule fancier or enthusiast for over 50. When I was very young, my early ambition was to be a jockey, and that was really my father's idea, but I grew a little bit too tall for that. But I did have an interest in horses that was nurtured by my mother, who urged me to read books by Walter Farley, who was a family friend. And of course, anybody who's read any horse books would recognize that name as the author of the Black Stallion series. My personal involvement with horses has been largely through polo, and that's been a great experience too. But now it's your turn, and we're going to try to have a poll here. Now, there are going to be three questions in the poll. This is the first one. Hold on. Can we close that poll, please? Andrea, for a second. I hope people can just click on that and hide that poll. We're going to have three questions. The first one is about your background. Are you a horse owner, enthusiast, veterinarian, et cetera, et cetera. The second one will be your location. I'd let you know where you're from, either in the U.S., part of the U.S. or outside the U.S. And the third one, I would like to know your interest in horses. So those are the three questions. And now if we could have the poll on again and see how it works. Good, people are chiming in. That's right. We've got 40% people participating so far. This is great. Up to 57, 60%. Keep going, keep going. That's good. And someone's raised her hand too, Janet Durso. I wonder what that is about. Two participants raised hand. Oh, some people need the passcode, I think. All of the above, could I have a passcode? Are you having Zoom issues? Yeah. Okay, up to 86. All right, Bakers, 10 seconds left. Let's roll it. I think we've got a really good percentage take rate now already here. That's great. Okay. So, Andrea, let's close the poll. And can we share the results with the audience? I can't tell if
they're
you all can see.
Now.
They're shared. Yep. Oh, great. Mm-hmm. Okay, excellent. So we've got 50% horse owners, 25% vets, a few veterinary students, mostly from the Northeast. Oh, gosh, almost 20% of the people from outside the U.S. That's really nice. And quite a lot of people who have an interest in mules and donkeys, and that's just great. Okay. Well, you all know a little bit about one another now too, and that's really good. So you've seen the answers. Now we're going to go on to the next part of the presentation. I think I'll close that. And we'll see about the introduction to the horse family. Okay, so here you see six panels which represent six of the main species in the genus Equus. It's not really a scientific family. It's a genus, which is a more closely related group of animals. Horse, donkey, one of the zebra, a second zebra, the Grevy zebra, the plain zebra on the upper right, and then the Kiang or the onager from the Asian half ass, it's called, and Przewalski's horse. So, and there's a few others species too, but these are the main groupings. And you'll see when you look underneath each of the pictures that there's a chromosome number, 2N complement of chromosome for these species with their Latin name abbreviation. And the species, the chromosome numbers range from 44 up to 64. That's a huge variation in chromosome number in these species of equids. And the amazing thing is that they can all interbreed with one another. It's extraordinary that species that have this great a difference in chromosome numbers can breed successfully to produce viable offspring. And the most common animal hybrid is of course the mule, which is the mule is the result of a mating between a male donkey and a female horse. That would be a jack donkey crossed with a mare. And the mule is really recognized universally as the quintessential mammalian hybrid. So now we have our next question, which is going to come up in a minute. And I'd like you to tell me the name of the cross between a male horse and a female donkey. So Andrea, if you could please launch this quiz, and we'll this little poll, and we'll see how this goes. Doing great, 50% already. Smashing on, great. Gosh, when we get to 85, I can probably stop. We'll have a good idea of what people are thinking out there. Yep, that's good. I think we can close that off now. Very good. And are you showing this now? Is this the results of the poll?
They're being shared, yep.
Shared, oh, great, excellent. So we've got the winner is the Hinny. And of course, that's the right answer. But there's a few people put down Mule, Berdegano, Janet, Bardotto, Mollisel, Jenny, no idea. Let's see how that goes there with that. I'm going to close that and go on to the next slide. So the correct answer is Hinny, but the words that are in red in this list here are names of the Hinny in other languages. Berdegano, Bardotto, Mollisel. Mula is Spanish for mule. Jenet is another word for a female donkey. Jenny is another word for a female donkey. And I've always been interested in why there are so many different names for Hinny compared to mule. These are the languages on this column here: English, Spanish, Portuguese, French, Italian, and German. Male donkey cross female horse, mule, mula, mula, mule, mulo, mula. And Moultier, which is almost a mule root in there, but not quite. But Hinny has much more, well, more variation. Hinny, Berdegano in Spanish, very different from the Bardotto, Bardo, and Bardotto, which are Portuguese, French, Italian names, and Mollisel, which is related to Moultier, I expect, from the German. But there are more different names for Hinny than mule. I wonder why that might be. Maybe we can discuss that later on in the question time. So going back again to our reciprocal hybrids now, if the male is a donkey and the female is a horse, we get a mule. And if the male is a horse and the female is a donkey, we get a hinny. The horses have 64 chromosomes, the donkeys have 62, and the mules and the hinnies both have 63. They have half the chromosome complement. Half the chromosome complement of it's midway between the two parent species. Now, when we think about these two reciprocal hybrids, we want to think about how inheritance differs between males and females. The male produces sperm, as you know, and the sperm is a little packet that has the nuclear DNA in it on a little tail. Not a very good drawing of a sperm. Apologize for that. Female produces an egg, which is very large. It has lots of cytoplasm and other proteins in it. It's got a nucleus with nuclear DNA in it. And then that nuclear DNA can be translated into messenger RNA. So there's lots of instructions out in the cytoplasm. But there's also these other subcellular organelles called mitochondria. And mitochondria are they're remnants of bacteria which colonized eukaryotic cells with nuclei millions and millions of years ago and lost their ability to live freely, but they now live in a symbiotic relationship with eukaryotic cells, and they have their own complement of DNA, and that's called mitochondrial DNA. Now, males and females have mitochondrial DNA, but in the process of forming a sperm, virtually no mitochondrial DNA is packaged with the sperm. And almost all of the mitochondrial DNA that you inherit comes from your mother. And this is the way that geneticists have traced maternal lineages of humans and many other species, is by following the inheritance of the mitochondrial DNA. So mitochondrial DNA comes from only from the mother's line. So when we think about mules and hinnies, they both have 63 chromosomes, but they have different mitochondrial DNA. This is a picture of a hinny suckling its donkey mother. So its mitochondrial DNA is going to be of the donkey type, whereas the mule will have horse type mitochondrial DNA. And that gives them different genetic makeup. They also grow up in a different uterine environment. This little hinny is growing up in the uterus of a donkey mother, and the mule grows up in a horse mother. And there are lots of differences that can apply there too. But we're going to consider how else mules and hinnies might differ as we go along this evening. So that was the introduction to the horse family and some essentials about mules and hinnies. Now we're going to talk a little bit about the enduring utility of the mule. So how do we know how long people have had mules? Well, we just read the Bible. And if you read the Bible, you can find lots of references to the mule. And here are some of them here. And some of them are quite apropos. The first one is about some sort of infectious disease. Such also shall be the plague on the horse and the mule, on the camel and the donkey, and on all the cattle that will be in those camps. So shall this plague be. We don't really know what this plague is, and I've been unable to think of an infectious disease which would infect these animals and not others. One might be rabies, but I don't think they're really talking about rabies here, but we could talk about this in the discussion too. The second one, this involves some people's perceptions of mules. Then Absalom met the servants of David, and he rode on a mule, and the mule went under the thick boughs of a great terebinth tree, and his head caught in the terebinth, and he was left hanging between heaven and earth, and the mule which was under him went on. You can imagine that picture in your head, and some people might think that serves them right for trying to ride a mule. We go further on down to Kings. We say, and Ahab had said to Obadiah, go to the land, to all the springs of water and to all the brooks. Perhaps we may find grass to keep the horses and mules alive so that we will not have to kill any livestock. Well, there's a equine welfare right there in that passage, and a lovely one it is. And finally, we have from Nehemiah, their horses were 736 and their mules were 245. I think that's about 25% mules in this version here. Well, that's enough for the Bible. We'll come back to that last ratio in a minute. Depictions of mules in the ancient world. This is another way we can learn about mules. There's a muleography website where I got these images. There are many bas-relief or mosaics on walls and floors around the Middle Eastern area that have depicted mules going back to the 1,000, 2,000, 3,000 years ago. So that's a second way. You can read the Bible. You can look at what we have in archaeology in the ancient world. And a third way is to look at ancient DNA. And over the last 4 or 5 years, there have been quite a few important scientific papers produced, many of them produced by a fellow named Ludovic Orlando, who's an absolutely brilliant ancient DNA specialist based in France right now. And Ludovic published this paper just in 2022, where he compared DNA work with morphometrics, trying to figure out whether an equid bone was from a horse, a donkey, or a mule. And he was very good at determining whether those bones belong to, or teeth belong to, a horse or a donkey or a mule. But what he found, which was important, was that 15% of the ancient equids from the Bronze Age, which is 1500 to 500 BC, in the Roman part of the world, were mules. That's about one out of six animals, very close to the ratio we get from the Bible. So they hold up pretty well. And there's another paper that came out last year, which describes a 4,500-year-old hybrid between a donkey and a hemip. And that's the one of the, like a Syrian wild ass. And I don't know that much about that paper. It's a complicated one, but that pushes the age of man-made hybrids back even further than the ones from the Bronze Age, when there was clear evidence for lots of mules and utility of those mules. So the mules have been around for a long time. What about the United States? Well, we've got a pretty long history of mules here too. On the left, you see a cover of a brochure from the Farmer's Bulletin. This was produced in the middle of the 20th century, showing how to, it's a brochure on mule production. And on the right, many of you who are older might remember 20 Mule Team Borax and how mules would help sell that product in the 1950s and 60s and earlier than that. There's a very famous story about George Washington, who received jack donkeys from France and used them to breed mules. Royal gift was the jack donkey he received. And he started to breed mules in the United States. So he was the first prominent mule breeder in the U.S. Another president, Harry Truman, who was from Missouri, was very, very fond of mules. His father was a farmer and a mule breeder. And mules have found great use not only in agriculture, but in warfare. These are some pack mules from World War I on the lower right. There are brochures which were produced by the U.S. Department of Agriculture, which show the census of mules around the country. I'm sorry, this one is a little bit fuzzy, but each of those symbols represents, 100 mules or 1,000 mules or some figure like that. And I've got some other ones that I'll show you next. This slide shows the distribution of cotton and mules in the United States, in the Southeast United States in 1850. And you can see there's a very close overlap between the distribution of cotton and the location of the mules. Each of these dots represents 1,000 mules. And over time, these kind of maps were kept by the Census Department, Department of Agriculture, 1900, 1925, 1940, and 1950. And what you can see from this is that there was an incredibly dense population of mules in the southeastern United States that lasted well into mid-century, well after tractors were developed and had replaced mules as farm animals. And one of the reasons there were still so many mules in 1950 is that they have a very, very long lifespan. They just refuse to die. They're very, very healthy and long-lived animals. There were probably 4 or 5 million mules in the United States at the peak of mule production. And they were really important in our agricultural production for many years. If some of you might have been up to Syracuse and seen this statue of one of the Erie Canal mules and its handler, that's a famous one. And out in West Texas, there's a town called Mule Shoe. And this is the mule, that's the mule statue in Mule Shoe, Texas, another beautiful, beautiful example of a mule. And I hope you can get out there and see that sometime. So we've had a quick run through utility of mules over the past 3 or 4 millennia. But we might ask whether the mule has a future. It certainly had a glorious past, but does it have a future? Well, out in the West, people still race mules. I'm not sure why they'd want to do that, but they do. Mules have been used as pack animals and especially for trips up into the mountains out in the West. And they're also used in endurance riding. They're extremely good endurance animals. Some people even use them in 3-day eventing. And of course, there's still mule shows like this one shown here. I think this was down in Missouri somewhere where they're still very fond of mules. And I think at the vet school in Missouri, they still have a mule fanciers club for the students. So the mule has a future, but it probably is not as bright as the one it had in the past, but we'll have to see. So now we're on to the section on the contribution of the mule to scientific thought. And this is the heart of our discussion today. Why would you want to study mules? Well, it turns out the mules have a very long history of advancing our understanding of the natural world. And they've probably made contributions which are greater than those that have been achieved by the studies of horses or donkeys or zebras or any other members of the horse family. And in fact, the discoveries made in mules probably have as much prominence as those made by any made in any domestic species. And we'll talk about a few of them tonight. Well, first, the mule is the first genetically engineered animal. And this people knew about this thousands of years ago. It's the embodiment of the term hybrid vigor. The mule has the best characteristics of both parent species. It's smarter, it's more disease resistant than a horse. It's stronger than a donkey. It's long, very long lived, as I mentioned before. And specifically for the mule breeder, the man or woman who breeds mules, the mule can't reproduce. So his market or his or her market is secure. He sells a mule to someone, and that the buyer cannot breed that mule and make more mules. He has to come back to the mule breeder and buy another one might be every 20 or 40 years, but he can still hold that market. Now, this is an interesting one. Aristotle and Pythagoras were really smart guys, but they were a little bit misguided when it came to how reproduction works. They had a theory of preformationism, and this was developed between the times of Pythagoras and Aristotle, hundreds of years before in BC, right up to the 1500s, when Paracelsus is credited with the first mention of the term homunculus. And homunculus was this little man who supposedly lives in a sperm. Spermists held the belief that the sperm was in fact a little person, little man, that was placed inside a woman for growth into a child. This seemed to them to neatly explain many of the mysteries of conception. So the homunculus hypothesis is the seed and soil hypothesis, that the father produces the seed, the mother produces the soil, and there's no genetic role for the mother. Everything in reproduction happens through the father. And it's hard to believe that people thought that, but they did. But the mule is clearly a blend of horse and donkey. And so if you just look at the parent species and look at the mule, you recognize immediately that both parents have a role in reproduction. So this debunks the idea of homunculus and the preformationism theory, which was held for hundreds and hundreds of years. That's an interesting one. Now, more recently, there have been many genetic studies of mules and hinnies, and these were summarized very beautifully by my colleague and friend, Roger Short, who sadly died a couple of years ago, but he was a great British veterinary scientist and reproductive specialist. And he wrote a little paper called The Contributions of the Mule to Scientific Thought and summarized many of the advances made by studies of the mule. Roger was a wonderful guy. Here's some of them right on this paper here. There's evidence for so-called imprinted genes, and I'm going to come back to these later on. That's a very complicated bit of business. You remember we talked about mitochondrial DNA and how we know that it's inherited in mammals only through the mother. Well, the way we know that it's inherited only through the mother is through studies of mules and hinnies. Clyde Hutchinson in 1974 published a really important paper in Nature where he isolated mitochondria from horses, donkeys, mules, and hinnies and did partial DNA sequencing of that mitochondria and showed that horses and mules had the same kind of mitochondria and donkeys and hinnies had the same kind of mitochondria, showing that the mitochondria were inherited from the mother and not from the father. So that was a really important advance. This is not just for horse medicine or horse science. This is for biology in general. There were also several papers published in the 1970s on X chromosome inactivation patterns in mules and hinnies, which supported the lion hypothesis. And that's the idea that females have two X chromosomes, and in order to make females and males more equal to one another, the female has to inactivate one of her X chromosomes in every cell. And that's well-known process of X inactivation now. And again, there were really good studies based upon mules, which showed that this was the case in horses and donkeys. And this is based upon the fact that the X chromosome, the genes on the X chromosome have variants that are different between horses and donkeys, so that it's quite easy to distinguish them from one another. And finally down here, here's a evidence for the first cloned equid was done by Gordon Woods, who's a former Cornell professor. And this was done in 2003. So the first member of the horse family to be cloned was in fact a mule. And it was one of those racing mules we mentioned earlier on from out in Washington State and Idaho. Idaho, I think this one was from. So many, many, many advances made by studies of the mule. Here's a summary of a couple of these others from the mid-1960s. Kurt Benerschke laid the foundation for this by characterizing the chromosomes of horse, donkey, and the hybrids. Kurt Benerschke was a really famous guy. He was an MD who used to be at Dartmouth College in Hanover, but moved to California, to San Diego, and ended up as the director and first director and the person who started the Research Institute of the San Diego Zoo. And he made many, many studies of the placenta and genetics of a large number of species. And one of his favorites was the horse family. And there was another friend and colleague over many years who sadly passed away now too, but he was a great, great fellow. And here are two papers cited below. One on sex linkage of glucose 6-phosphate dehydrogenase gene in equidae. It's basically the same result found by two different groups, Trujillo, and this one was published by a couple of people, including Susumu Ono. And they just showed that this particular enzyme was linked to the X chromosome back in the mid-1960s by studying mules and hinnies. And it's hard to believe this now, but that was a big advance in those days to show that a gene was located on a particular chromosome. But again, it was easier to do this by studies of horses and donkeys and their hybrids because of the differences in the genetic sequence of this gene between those species. Now, Susumu Ono, he was another guy that I knew pretty well. He was an amazing, amazing man, a Japanese veterinarian who was a geneticist and worked in the United States for most of his career at the City of Hope Medical Center in Duarte, California. And he was a great theorist in evolutionary genetics. And he was also a fantastic dressage rider and competitor in dressage competitions, and really, really wonderful man. And I was really fortunate to know him early on in my career. Okay, so now we'll come to mule fertility. Most equids can hybridize, as we've discussed already, horse cross zebra, zebra cross horse, but few crosses have been studied widely. Now, they haven't been studied widely because of many reasons, but one of them is that the fertility of different crosses is not equal. The fertility of the mule and hinny pregnancies is very unequal. The mule pregnancy, mating a jack donkey with a mare, this is highly fertile and it's similar to intraspecies matings. It's equally fertile to horse cross horse or donkey cross donkey. But the opposite cross, the stallion crossed with the jenny donkey, it's very, very infertile. Offspring are rare. In fact, in our experience, my experience with another colleague of mine that I'll come to in a bit, Professor Twink Allen, we found that only about 1 in 7 female donkeys would conceive hybrids when mated to a stallion. So a very infertile cross. And we'll come back to that in a little bit too. So fertility, pregnancy and interspecies hybrids. The mules and hinnies themselves can be fertile, but pregnancies in the hybrids is very, very, very rare. Fertile male mules and hinnies have never been documented, and this follows Haldane's law. JBS Haldane was a famous geneticist of the early 1900s, and he observed a lot in nature, and he came up with this law that states that in interspecies hybrids, the heterogametic sex will be less fertile or absent. So, and the heterogametic sex means XY chromosome. So that would mean you'd find fewer male mules than you would female mules. In fact, that's been borne out. If you have 100 mares that you're breeding to a jack donkey, you wouldn't get 50 male mules and 50 female mules born from those matings. You'd have a slight excess of the females. And we're not sure why that happens, but the female is more, it's a more viable cross. But in any case, the males are also less fertile. So there's never been a documented fertile male mule or male hinny. However, fertile female mules have been described, but they are also very rare. They produce oocytes, that is eggs, and many of the examples of a fertile female mule go like this. That female mule produces an egg which has only the full set of maternal chromosomes. And that means that if you have a mule whose mother is a mare, most of the fertile mules, when bred to a jack donkey, would produce another mule. And if they were bred to a horse, they would produce 100% horse. They wouldn't produce anything sort of three-quarter horse and one-quarter donkey. More recently, there have been a few exceptions to this, and those are also very interesting. And this slide gives an example of that certain combinations of horse and donkey chromosomes can give rise to fertile backcross pregnancies in female mules and female hinnies. Backcross is mating the mule or the hinny back to a stallion or a jack donkey. Now, there's another way to make mules pregnant, and that is to implant them with embryos. And that's what we did here at Cornell way back a long time ago. And these are images from some of the pregnancies that we established here at Cornell. We have some mules that are carrying donkeys and mules carrying horses. And this is a beautiful picture of a mule just looking at her newborn foal with such loving maternal eyes. I never get over the beauty of that picture. She was a really fantastic, fantastic mother. These were enjoyable experiments. And they also had a scientific basis. In this case, we used the mules as a neutral incubator. And some of you who know a little bit about horse reproduction and donkey reproduction would know that the gestation of the horse is about 11 months. And for the donkey, it's about 12 months. So if you put a donkey embryo into a mule and a horse embryo into a mule, what would you expect the gestation length to be? If the gestation lengths are different and they reflect the gestation of the animals within their own species, that suggests that it's the fetus that's determining the length of gestation. The fetus determines when it's time to come out. And if it's not, then it may be a maternal signal for parturition. And our results suggested that it's the fetus that is the main decider for when it's time to be born. Those experiments were done with Dr. Twink Allen, Professor Twink Allen from Cambridge. And here he is with his graduate student, Julia Kidd, looking for an embryo in a cylinder back in the 1980s here at Cornell. Twink was really the world expert in equine embryo transfer. And he got very bored making horse transfers. So he started doing other kinds. He transferred zebra embryos into horses into donkeys into horses, Przewalski horse into horse, and they would all go to term without any real problems. except for one cross, the donkey and horse, which I won't really talk about today, but he was just amazing. And he did those mule experiments with us here at Cornell. Sadly, he died a few years ago too, but really wonderful man. And this is one of his pictures from his herd in Cambridge, showing all these interesting crosses derived from embryo transfer. Okay, so now we're going to spend a couple of minutes on the difficult part, and this is epigenetics and the genomic imprinting inheritance. And it's another really important part of biology that has been highlighted by through studies of the mule and hilly. The easy part of epigenetics is shown here. This is a cover picture of a couple of identical twin horses made by splitting one horse embryo into two parts and putting it into two separate mares to gestate. This was also done by Twink Allen over in Cambridge. And you can see that these two horses don't look like identical twins, even though they come from the same embryo. The white strip on their faces are different, and the amount of white on the hoofs are different. And we now know that that's due to the differential migration of pigmented or non-pigmented cells in the early stages of the embryo. And if there are slight differences in the degree of migration of those cells in these two identical bits of embryonic tissue that are incubating in different mothers, then that can be exaggerated over the whole term of gestation, so that the animals won't look absolutely identical. But if you look at their DNA, they are in fact identical twins. So that's an example of how the environment can shape your genetics, and that kind of shaping of physiology is called epigenetics. Now, the essential biology of imprinting goes like this, and that is that paternal and maternal genomes contribute differently to development. What does that mean? Well, I've just used this slide to let you know, remind you that for most of the genes in your genome, we all have about 20,000 to 30,000 genes. For most of those genes, it doesn't matter whether you inherit your gene from your mother or your father. It's going to act in the same way, no matter which parent you inherit it from. So for example, we know that the brown gene for brown eyes is a dominant gene. And if you have a mating between a brown-eyed male and a blue-eyed female, and then the offspring is going to have brown eyes, because it inherits the brown gene from the father. If the mother was brown-eyed and the father was blue-eyed and you did the same kind of mating, the offspring would have brown eyes because the brown gene is dominant, and it doesn't matter whether you inherit it from your mother or your father. But in genomic imprinting, there's a small number of genes, about 100 that are known in mice and in horses, whereas only the maternal or paternal copy of a gene is active in any given cell. These genes are so-called imprinted genes, and they're critical for regulating normal mammalian development. So here's an example of one of those genes, or two of those genes. These are genes that regulate growth, and many of the imprinted genes, these 100 or so genes, regulate growth. Two of the genes are IGF-2, insulin-like growth factor, and IGF-2 receptor. So it's a gene for a little cellular hormone and the receptor for that hormone, which sits on a cell surface. We know from studies in mice and now from studies in horses and donkeys and mules and hinnies as well, that when you have an offspring of two parents, the father's copy of the hormone, the IGF-2 insulin-like growth factor, this growth factor, only the father's copy is active. The mother's copy is switched off. But for the receptor, the mother's copy is active and the father's copy is shut off. It's like a switch on a light switch. And this is very unusual and hasn't been seen. And it's very different from other kinds of typical Mendelian inheritance. And the first evidence for this kind of inheritance in mammals may well have come from studies of of equine pregnancies, in interspecies in equine pregnancies. This work was done by Professor Twink Allen, just when he was a graduate student at Cambridge back in the 1960s. And he published this wonderful paper. It was a single author paper in Nature. And he measured hormone called ECG. In those days, it was called PMSG for pregnant mare's serum gonadotropin. He measured this hormone in horse pregnancies and in donkey pregnancies and in mule and hinny. And he found that in the horse, there was high levels of this hormone. And this hormone is produced by the placenta. So it's produced by the fetus, not by the mother. This is 120 units per mil of mother's blood. The hormone is released into the mother's blood by the placenta. Low levels were produced by the donkey. So if you expected this hormone to behave like we've just described for the mule or hinny, that is the hybrid animal looks like a blend of the two parent species, you'd expect there to be a midway level of hormone in the hybrid pregnancies. But in the hybrid pregnancies were very different. You can see here when there was a mule fetus, this is a mare carrying a mule bred by a donkey. It was a low level, just like the donkey. And when the Jenny donkey was carrying a hinny, there were high levels, just like the horse. So the level of hormone produced by the placenta seemed to be determined by the father. When the horse pregnancy has a horse father, hinny pregnancy has a horse father, donkey pregnancy has a donkey father, and mule has a donkey father. So the level of hormones determined by the father. This is a bit like this IGF-2. This level is determined by the father's copy is active and the mother's copy is inactive. And there's lots of ways in which we could explain that, but I'm going to run out of time and have to leave it here for now. But it's a really interesting example of how an early study of horse pregnancies gave us a hint of the existence of this type of inheritance called imprinting inheritance, which was not discovered until 1985. So between 1969 and 1985, this paper was the only evidence for that kind of inheritance. I'm going to skip through a bunch of these other slides now, because we're getting close to the end of the hour and we're going to go to the examination. This is the Cornell Equine Genetic Center Mule Hinny Quiz. Now, some horsemen contend that the mule has the extremities, that is the head, the tail, and legs of a donkey and the body of a horse, while the hinny has the opposite characteristics. Some of you who know about mules might have read about these things. People who own mules and hinnies say they can tell them apart by looking at them. We've already discussed that they have different mitochondrial DNA and they grow up in a different maternal environment and they have different imprinted genes, which would make them different. So there's a genetic basis for differences between mules and hinnies. I'm going to show you some images of heads and bodies of four hybrids. And they were purpose-bred here at Cornell using closely related thoroughbred mares and stallions and jacks and jennies. And there are many possibilities. You could be looking at four mules, four hinnies, or various mixtures. But it's unlikely we'd use four mules or four hinnies. And I want you to see if you can pick out the ones that are mules and which ones are hinnies. So these are the heads, A, B, C, and D. And we're going to ask you later on or in just a minute. Can we close that, please? Andrea, we're not quite ready for that yet. Nope, close them up. And then we're going to show you some bodies, A, B, C, and D. And now, let's see, let's have the poll. And the top choice for each of these is going to be mule, and the bottom choice will be hinny. So can we launch the poll? So for number A, do you think it's a mule or a hinny? Please answer. You're doing great. Nearly 20% now. almost 50%. Slowing down. Maybe people are getting to the stage where they cannot decide. But even this amount of participation is good. That's a lot of people. Got over 100 people voting now. Great. 70%. Have to vote faster. We're going to run over the hour. I think we'll close it when we get to 75. Oh, maybe we won't get there. Oh, okay, there we are. Okay, let's close that. Great. So now we're going to have the answer key. We have the answer key here. Is that showing now, Andrea?
The results are showing.
The results are showing.
And they, oh, yep. And they're.
So people can see this.
So, it says, yeah, A, B, C, D, and then an option for each.
They can see the bars?
Not the answers.
They can't? Oh, can they see the answers?
I don't believe so. Someone tell me if I'm wrong.
All right, but you can see the image with the mules and the hinnies heads, right?
Yes. And next to okay. A, it says A, mule, B, hinny.
Right. Okay. Okay, we'll just leave that. You've done your poll. Now let's do the poll for the whole body. Now you can see the animal's whole body. And it's a new poll. Great. I wish you could all see this in real time because I can see the little boats coming in and see how they're rolling. We'll look at them in a minute, I hope. Going faster on this one. You're up to 64% already. Hasn't been a minute yet. We'll get to 75 and we'll stop them. I hope we'll get to 75. Maybe we'll just have to stop.
You might have stumped people.
Yeah. Okay. Well, let's let's move on, Doug. Oh, answer key. Okay. So now, is this the answer being displayed now for everybody?
Yes. There's a red answer next to each animal.
Right. But can they see the poll quiz results too?
It's currently being shared. Yes.
Oh, great. Okay. So you can see how you did. 75% voted mule for number A, and you got it. That was great. For B, it's a hinny, and you've got that too. But it's not so clear. C, it is a hinny, and you got that one. And for the last one, you got mule too. So you're doing really great. Wow, this is the best this has ever happened. Can you show the body? Oh, this is the body quiz now, or was that the body? I can't remember. In any case, this looks good.
That was the body results. Yep.
Yes, this is excellent. This is I've given this quiz many, many times, and this group has done better than any group I've ever seen. I've only done it using in real time now. Never in a Zoom format. All right. Okay, final questions. So why are hinnies so rare? Why is the mating between horse and donkey rare when you have a stallion crossed with a jenny donkey? That's something that we don't really understand, but there's lots of good reproductive technology now available so that this question can be examined. That is using techniques like intracytoplasmic sperm injection or in vitro fertilization. And it's a really interesting one. Why do horsemen think that mules and hinnies have distinct phenotypes? Why do they look different from one another? Well, you guys can tell me that now, because you've done really well in this quiz overall. I think you've been able to pick out the mules from the hinnies better than any group I've ever asked about this. In the past, it's always come out 50-50. So that's great. Now, to wrap up, why is the mule the most important member of the horse family? We've had an introduction to the horse family, talked about the enduring utility of the mule, many contributions of the mule to scientific thought, and you've had a chance to participate in the Cornell Mule Hinnie quiz, and you've done very, very well. So that's what we've discussed today. Acknowledgements. In my lab, Don Miller, who's worked with me for many years on these projects, with and Andy Clark and Xu Wang in the molecular biology and genetics group, and my two dear friends, departed friends, Roger Short and Twink Allen, both taught me so much about mules and hinnies and horses and horse reproduction, and I must thank them for everything. They were great friends. So that's the end. I think we can now...
Thank Close. You so much, Dr. Antczak. We do have a couple minutes for questions, and people can enter them in the Q&A if they've been brewing on them and now want to ask them. There was an interesting question. Someone had heard about the increased incidence of neonatal isoerythrolysis in
mules.
Sorry. Yeah. Right. You know, right. What we've been talking about for an hour, over horses. And mm-hmm. I think they're interested in hearing a little bit about that and or any other kind of fetal and maternal diseases that might be more common in mules or mule pregnancies.
God, that could be a long answer. But yeah. So hemolytic disease of the newborn or neonatal erythrolysis occurs in humans and it occurs in horses. When it occurs in horses, in horse-horse matings, it's quite rare, and it's only due to a couple of different red blood cell types. These are genes that control red blood markers on proteins on red blood cells, carbohydrates on red blood cells. The red blood cell markers between horses and donkeys are quite different, so that virtually every mule pregnancy, the first pregnancy, will sensitize the mother, and she'll make antibodies against the donkey red blood cell markers that differ from hers. And then in the second pregnancy, you often do get a higher titer of these antibodies. More antibodies are produced. And when the foal is born, if it ingests a lot of colostrum, the milk from the mother, first milk from the mother, you can get destruction of the red blood cells in the newborn, and they will die really easily. So it's because there's so many genetic differences between the red blood cell types of the horses and donkeys. It doesn't seem to affect the first pregnancy, though, the first mule pregnancy.
Right, that makes sense. Thank you very much. I want to personally know the answer to this question. Do you know if there are any distinct personality differences between hinnies and mules, maybe anecdotally or scientifically?
Well, you know, I think that the mules tend to spend more time with horses because they had a horse mother, and the hinnies tend to spend more time with donkeys if they're in a group and can choose because they had a donkey mother. Right. There probably are maternal effects maternal environment effects that can influence their behavior, but we've never had enough of those animals to be able to study them right. in detail. But that would be a great project. There's a very successful hinnie breeder. We're in the middle of Brazil, who produces lots and lots of hinnies, and I'd love to go down and study some of those someday. But the problem is the hinnies are very, very rare. We've only produced 3 hinnies here at Cornell in 30 years of breeding, and I've never seen another hybrid that I knew was a hinny anywhere in the world. They're very, very rare animals.
Mm-hmm. I remember trying to breed some myself in your lab.
Yeah.
And then, so Amy McLean has an interesting question. She says, do you have any information on the uterine environment being different in jennies compared to mares as a possible reason for lower conception rates when making a hinny cross? Or is it due to differences in horse semen and acrosome reaction?
Really good question. Good question, Amy. Twink Allen did a lot of studies in where he would try to recover embryos from jennies bred with horse semen very, very early after mating, and he could never find any fertilized embryo. So he thinks it's a problem with the sperm getting into the egg. So it might be acrosome reaction or something of that sort. That's where that seems to be heading. And again, using ICSI or intracytos plasmic sperm injection could really address those kind of questions. And I hope someone can do those soon. It would be really great.
Mm-hmm. I think there are a lot of questions.
Is it possible for a mule embryo to be?
Yeah, thank you.
Pregnant with the mule mother.
So I was trying to interpret that one.
Yeah, I think, some people, I think, in Colombia have taken a mule embryo and put it into another mule. So a mule has carried a mule to term. Right. I think that's happened now very recently. That's really good experiment.
Mm-hmm.
Has anyone performed hinny embryos in 2 years? Well, is it okay for me to read these?
Please do. Yes. I was trying to see if there were any similarities, but go ahead. Yes.
Okay. Yeah. Performed embryo transfer of hinny embryos into mares. No, it's hard to get hinny. It's hard to get hinny embryos. It's really, really hard. If anybody can do that, I'd love to hear about those experiments. It's so hard to get a hinny pregnancy. Very hard to do that. Commercial tests to differentiate mule versus hinny. I don't think there's a commercial one, but there's plenty of relatively easy ways to do it genetically, looking at mitochondrial DNA. Can you estimate the pregnancy obtained when the jennies are pregnant with a horse? The pregnancy rates transfer range. Oh, Esther, that's a long question. I'm trying to figure out that one. Muscle density fibers. My two mules are much stronger than my horse. Hmm. And yeah, that's the hybrid vigor from Mary Hassell. That's a yes. That would be a good one to pursue too. Oh gosh. Right, 12 pregnant mules, horse. Wow, from Hernan Ramirez, who's bred a lot of embryo transfer pregnancies. That's great. Awesome mothers, exactly they are. And their milk is some of the rarest milk on earth, to have milk from a mule. Over in the, gosh, in Mongolian, those places out there, they drink mare milk, but boy, that would be a real hot seller if you could sell the mule milk. There, that would be great. Awesome mothers, indeed they are. We had wonderful experiences with our pregnant mule mothers. They were very, very good mothers. We're working on donkey, zebra, and horse ICSI hybrids. That's good. Andres Gambini, excellent. Write to us. Come visit us. Come work with us.
Please do. Right. Wow. Anything well, lots of passion about mules worldwide.
Yes.
And sorry, it looks like we have gone over a bit. If anyone has any burning questions that we didn't get to, please do feel free to reach out. And I think we'll be sending a follow-up email with some contact information for us, and then also the recording once it's ready for those of you who maybe couldn't get in on time or just want to watch it over and over. So thank you very much, everyone. and thank you, Dr. Antczak. And we'll see you again next month. I'll actually be speaking with a colleague of mine about equine end-of-life decision-making. And I look forward to seeing everyone there soon. Thank you, everyone.
Well, it's great to see you all. Thanks for the excellent questions.
Thanks, Doug.
Thanks, everybody. Thanks, guys.
Good night.